Geeks, and welcome to the channel. Java's Spring Framework is with no doubt the most popular, open-source, enterprise-level framework for creating standalone, production-grade applications that run on the Java virtual machine. Now, Spring Boot, which is the subject of today's video, is a project that is built on top of the Spring Framework. It provides an easier and faster way to set up, configure, and run both simple and web-based applications. In the last video of the series, we explained what REST is and what APIs are. Today, we're going to see how we can create APIs with the help of Spring Boot. To do this, let's first use the Spring Initializer to generate the base for our project. The link to the Initializer website can be found in the description below. After picking a name and a version, we're going to add the Spring Web dependency, which will help us create and expose APIs to our clients. Then we're going to add Spring Data JPA alongside a basic in-memory DB of your choice. Here we are going to pick H2. It will allow us to simulate an end-to-end application. And finally, you can optionally add the project Lombok dependency. After you generate the project and open it in IntelliJ, you will notice that the main class for our application and its properties file are automatically generated and configured for us. Okay, with all of this set, let's start by defining our data model, a simple video entity, let's say. We will add to it an auto-generated ID, a title, and a length. On top of that, we'll efficiently make use of the Lombok annotations and implement the equals and hashcode methods. As for JPA entities, all we need is the ID while comparing. Now, to make use of this entity, we'll need to generate a repository for it. This is done by creating an interface extending the built-in JPA repository class, as you can see. This interface, as is, empty, offers us all the basic CRUD operations on the database. And if we wish to add or create our own custom operation, we can do so by simply adding it to the interface, similarly to what we did with the findByTitle method. Okay, now that the repo part of our app is set up, let's take a look at its web part and start by setting up a simple controller, the video controller. In this controller, we'll expose the basic CRUD operations, so we'll be able to create videos, update, delete them, and retrieve them by title. To enable this, we need to first inject our video repository with the help of Lombok or by making use of the @autowired annotation. Then we will make use of this repository to call the basic respective methods that will allow us to retrieve, add, update, or delete the video we want. Okay, now that the core functionalities are ready to go, let's focus on adding a simple error handling mechanism with the help of the @exceptionHandler annotation. This will allow us to return a not found status error code to the user if a certain exception is thrown. Speaking of which, let's create our own custom exception as well. Now, by adding these extra checks to our existing methods, we made sure that no matter what the user inputs, we will always return a readable, user-friendly answer back. Finally, to expose these functionalities, we are going to create an interface for this controller and implement it. This API will contain all the methods we just saw, in addition to the REST or HTTP method annotations indicating whether to use a POST, GET, PUT, or DELETE method respectively. That's it! Let's now add a simple front end using Swagger. This is simply done by adding the dependency you see and navigating to the URL in front of you. You can add a lot of descriptions and documentations to your Swagger page with the help of multiple annotations. But for the sake of this video, we will keep things as is, and maybe in a future video we will expand on this topic. Now, before ending the video, and as a side note here, notice that we're exposing our video entity as an external resource here. That's fine for this simple application, but in a real-world application, we'll probably want to separate these two concepts. We will dive deeper in this topic and in how to improve the overall design of our project in the next video of this series. So, this was a quick introduction to Spring Boot. Of course, we barely scratched the surface here. There's a lot more to this framework than we can cover in a single video. But don't worry, many more videos are on the way and will be added to this series, so stay tuned. And that's it for this one. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.